bad days, bad weeks, worst of all, bad years. We've all had them, but how we deal with those times, that is what matters most. And that is our topic today on Walking the Word TV. And we could not be more fired up to see you getting unstuck from depression. Amen. Pastor James, we're looking to the Old Testament today, but I can hear someone, they're watching right now, and they're wondering, what does a prophet who lived 3,000 years ago have to do with me today? But they have a point. I mean, we've come a long way in our therapy and treatment of emotional disorders.
For sure.
What does Elijah have to do with depression in today's world?
Well, the whole thing is based upon a misunderstanding of this reality, okay? Human nature remains the same. All right, it's not changing. It says in James chapter 5, Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. Okay, what do you think? Because you're in a car and you have a toaster that you don't feel the same things that Elijah felt? I mean, it's not the circumstances around us. It's what's inside us. That's where the battle is won or lost. And we want to help you get to a better place about that. I don't want to be insensitive in any way, but let me assure you that this is as timeless as though it just came out of the newspaper today, God's unchanging truth for our unchanging human condition.
We started this message last time, and if you missed any part of it, we're going to begin with a little review, and we just want you to remember, you always have access to more teaching, Bible study materials.
Right.
We got resources. That's all online at jamesmacdonald.org. Why don't you just pull out your smartphone and go on there right now while you're watching the program. Speaking of the program, let's get started right now with the message.
You know that most pastors resign from their church on Mondays. Mondays. Maybe you've led a seminar or ministered in a small group or intervened in a family crisis and tried to honor the Lord. When you are pouring yourself out to serve the Lord, you are exhausting yourself in a way that makes physical labor look like a vacation, and you are making yourself vulnerable. That's what Elijah was doing after intense ministry output. Then notice this, after relational conflict. Chapter 18, verse 40, Elijah said to them, so he goes and he gets into, how many people would consider executing 450 false prophets relational conflict? And so intense ministry output, relational conflict. Of course, nobody likes a relational conflict, and I would just say that the more important the relationship is to you, the bigger the issue in the relationship is to you, the more it is draining the life out of you. And if you find yourself saying sometimes, why am I so down? Why am I so down? Take a look at the things that we're talking about here, because in just a moment, you're going to see what happens to Elijah. So the timing, after intense ministry output, after relational conflict, after physical exhaustion, I already referenced that section there, 41 through 46, and he's exhausted, but he's still praying, and then he gets up and he runs a great distance. No wonder we're about to see what we're about to see after physical exhaustion. Parents, you've seen this with kids, right? See with your kids, and you get your kids up, and it's not living. They missed their nap, and they were at a birthday party, and they didn't have a chance to, and everything kind of unfolded in a different way than what they really expected. And all of a sudden, what happens to your kid about 6:30 at night? Yeah, he stole my cookie or something like that. Really, really, we're going to completely lose it over this? Parents, have we seen this? But that's only kids, right? It's only kids that get exhausted. Only children get cranky when they're exhausted. Amen? After physical exhaustion, this might surprise you, after a major victory, Ahab told Jezebel, chapter 19, verse 1, all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Talk about a victory. I mean, I think Elijah was probably thinking to myself, finally the king and queen are going to repent. Finally they're going to get on their knees and say that Yahweh is God. They're going to bow in humility. That's not what's going to happen. They're going to come after him even more strongly. Sometimes it's the thing that you waited for longest, that you most desired, when it actually happens and you find out it isn't everything that you thought it was going to be, right on the other side of that. You know, I just thought when I got that job, I just thought when I got that promotion, I just thought when we got into that house, I just thought when we got to that destination that everything was going to fall into place, and I had a lot of my hopes pinned on that. And then when it wasn't what I thought it was going to be, athletes wonder why they feel so empty when the trophy's finally on the shelf. Students wonder why they feel so unfulfilled with the diploma finally in their hands. Mothers wonder why they can't stop the tears with the healthy newborn sleeping in the nursery upstairs. We get up for the challenge, and when the victory's won, we're vulnerable on the other side. I didn't have any time to think about how I felt in the midst of the crisis, but now the crisis is past and the victory is logged, praise God, but somehow I sense that I'm not okay. Understanding the timing after a major victory or after a huge disappointment. 19:2, then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, so may the gods, which is just hilarious. You mean the gods that just let us kill all their prophets? You mean the gods that couldn't rain down a spark plug from heaven? Those gods? She's still on it. So may the gods do to me and more also if I don't make your life as the life of one of them by this time. You got 24 hours. She's evil for sure. Now, interesting. Man, he just paved 450 prophets, but one woman is about to lay him out. Then he was afraid, and he arose and ran for his life and came to Beersheba. Now, have you ever seen in the Bible where it says from Dan to Beersheba? Beersheba's as south as you can get, then you're in Egypt, okay? Dan, the tribe at the top, Beersheba at the bottom, he got as far as he could without leaving the country. If you know the geography, when it says he was afraid and he rose and he ran for his life and came to, as Beersheba is to Israel, so Cairo is to Illinois. All right? That's where he is, as far away as he could get. Ran for his life, came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and he left his servant there. Which leads to this next thing. And I probably wouldn't, I just wouldn't want you to misunderstand this, but sometimes if we understand our steps, we want to trace our steps. How did I get here? How many people have ever got themselves to a place emotionally where you said, you thought to yourself, how did I get here? You know what I'm talking about? How did I get over here? All right, so I don't mean this insensitively, but jot this down, how to get depressed. Three easy steps. Notice the first one here. Find a place by yourself. Find a place by yourself. Getting by yourself is the worst thing a discouraged person could do and the thing they want to do the most. Notice the verbs here. He ran for his life. He came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah. He left his servant, chapter 19, verse 3. He went a day's journey by himself into the wilderness. Who does that? How bad do you want to be alone if you walk away from Beersheba, where there was a beautiful oasis and a deep well and some lush vegetation, and he's like, no, no, and you walk for a whole day, what, 6, 8, 10, 12 hours walking out into the wilderness? Why? Want to be alone? You stay here. Well, I'm actually supposed to be with you, helping you. You're not coming. Well, but my main thing's to help you. I think I should come. You're not coming. I'm going by myself. Maybe you've been very, very alone. Maybe your church attendance has become intermittent because you don't like to be in a room with people taking input, being forced to think about something differently than the way you're thinking about it. Why won't he let the servant come? Because when you're planning a pity party, you can't take a chance that someone's going to show up with cupcakes. Funny, I guess humorously stated, but pretty unfunny if you're there. So that's the first thing. Three easy steps. It's not that far away. How gracious of God to send an angel to make a meal, to touch him, to insist that he eat it. And when you get into a really bad place, God can set a table before you in the presence of your enemies. And you're like, I don't want that.
Trusting God is a choice. I know it feels like we fall into fear. I didn't want to be fearful. It's not cognitive. We don't feel ourselves choosing to fear, but we are choosing to fear, and we can choose to trust. This is a life-changing, liberating truth. You can choose to trust God.
The disappointments of yesterday, the uncertainties of tomorrow, they're heavy, and they'll crush you. But only if you lose sight of the one who is always in control. Despite what you may be going through, God always has your best interest at heart. Every issue you're facing comes down to one question: will I trust him? We'd like to help you learn to say yes by sending you a copy of James MacDonald's sermon, I Choose to Trust. In this message, Pastor James reminds us that even in the midst of the most crushing uncertainty, God longs for you to put your faith in him. Ask for I Choose to Trust when you give a gift of any amount to Walk in the Word, and learn to put your life in God's hands where it belongs. And by supporting this ministry with a gift of $125 or more, we'd also like to send you the 10 CD series, 10 Choices, a proven plan to change your life forever, as well as the 10 Choices Bible Study. In this highly practical, impactful series, James MacDonald shares 10 choices that are sure to change your life forever. In addition, you can dig deeper with your own 120-page workbook that will help free you from guilt and regret and stop you from carrying around old hurts and anger. Ask for 10 choices when you call 800-545-6800 or go now to jamesmacdonald.tv.
A lingering dark cloud of depression is not that far away, spiritually speaking. That's the first thing. Find a place by yourself. Let me ask you here just five questions, just a little penetrating self-evaluation. Do you have less personal friends than you did a year ago? Does it make you angry when the phone rings, even if it's a friend for you? Are you spending less evenings out, retreating to the basement, away from family? A lot. Are you skipping small group, avoiding eye contact, avoiding church and other Christians altogether? Is your worst nightmare being trapped in a corner and someone saying, how are you really? How are you really doing? If you are attuned to Twitter at all, I tweeted this week about my brother. I told the church family last week that my brother had had a stroke, and I appreciate your prayers very much. I'm really not at liberty to say very much, except to say that it's very grim. when they use the word very and massive to describe a stroke in the same sentence. It's been a lot of crying this week, and apart from a miracle, I'm not just talking about trying hard at rehab, apart from a miracle. And I've been through enough to know that there are some ways that I could begin to think about this. You know, 28 years living 500 miles away, my younger brother who made his life very, very difficult for himself, and I could start thinking, what if I had been there more? What if? And there's like a whole way of thinking about things that takes you to a place that mitigates against your ability to even give the help that you would say you want to give. I can just see the options in front of me as I'm trying to do my job and process what has happened this week. And I can just sense there's a couple of ways that I could go with this that won't get me or anyone else to a better place. So Kathy called and we were talking on the phone, and she said, hey, you know, this one of the so many wonderful people in our church, but a couple that's been here just really almost forever, raised their family here, kids in college. We had for a year been trying to get over to their house. And Kathy called and said, I canceled the event because I flew in last night. She said, I canceled. And there was part of me that was like, thank God she canceled. Even though I really wanted to do that, I just didn't want to be. And I said to her, as I've been thinking about this all week, no, call back. So I flew into the airport, got in the car, went over there. They loved on us. We laughed. We had you. What you desperately need is the thing that you push off the most. And that's how it happens. If you want to get depressed, find a place by yourself. And then I've already alluded to this. Focus on the negative. Look at Elijah here in chapter 19, verse 10. He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord. This is his wilderness speech. I have been very jealous. I have worked hard for God. I have spent myself for the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, killed your prophets with the sword. Here it is. I only am left. Now, I would have got the point with I'm the only one left. What's he saying when he says, I only am the one? Nobody loves like me. Nobody cares like me. Nobody's given like me. Nobody deserves what's happening to me. This is the song they sing at pity parties. I only am left. Focused on the negative. The person who is struggling with depression, spiritually based depression, it's like this. All of life, right here. Look at the spot on the carpet! It's everywhere! No, it isn't everywhere. You're really, really focused on that. And that's what a depressed, debilitating pattern of thinking does. So you find a place by yourself, you focus upon the negative, and you forget God's provision for you. You forget the fact that God has been good, God has been faithful, God has done a lot for you. If you go and look here in the passage, he goes out and he says, he sits down under a broom tree, chapter 19, verse 4, he asks that he might die. Is it enough now, O Lord, take away my life? I'm no better than my fathers. He lay down and slept under a broom tree, which, by the way, a broom tree, that's where you'd go if every other tree was taken. You can study that yourself if you want to. A broom tree would be similar to someone holding their thumb up over you. So he's roasting in the sun. And behold, an angel touched him and said, "Arise and eat." He looked, and behold, there was at his head a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. And he ate and drank and lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, "Arise and go and eat, for the journey is too great for you." And he arose and ate and drank and went in the strength of that food for 40 days and 40 nights. When you're battling this spiritual depression, you forget how the Lord has been good to you. You forget how the Lord has been provided for you. You forget all the things. How gracious of God to send an angel to make a meal, to touch him, to insist that he eat it. And when you get into a really bad place, God can set a table before you in the presence of your enemies. And you're like, "I don't want that." I'm not saying that there aren't factors beyond our control. I'm just saying there are many things within our control. And God helps us when we attend to the things that we can deal with. Choosing the cure to depression. And number one, let God confront you. Right here in the text, it's just awesome, but just God just goes right to him. And maybe God's coming to you this weekend in church, and he's saying, "Why so downcast? Produce your strong reasons." And God comes straight to him and confronts him so personally and so directly. It's just really fantastic. Look at verse 9. "There he came to a cave and lodged in it, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?' And he gives the same speech. "I've been zealous for the Lord, and you know, I did this and I did..." And God just confronts him. And then notice this also, let God reveal himself to you. The Lord says to him, verse 11, "Go out and stand on the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountain, broke it in pieces. But the Lord was not in that wind. And then an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper." Some translations say they're a still, small voice. "And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave." How did you get to the place where you are? Why are you thinking the way that you're thinking? Let God confront you. Let God reveal himself to you. Receive God's provision for you. Do what God says immediately. And as Elijah does in verses 18 and 19, get involved with people again.
The disappointments of yesterday, the uncertainties of tomorrow, they're heavy and they'll crush you. But only if you lose sight of the one who is always in control. Despite what you may be going through, God always has your best interest at heart. Every issue you're facing comes down to one question: will I trust him? We'd like to help you learn to say yes by sending you a copy of James MacDonald's sermon, "I Choose to Trust." In this message, Pastor James reminds us that even in the midst of the most crushing uncertainty, God longs for you to put your faith in him. Ask for "I Choose to Trust" when you give a gift of any amount to Walk in the Word, and learn to put your life in God's hands where it belongs. And by supporting this ministry with a gift of $125 or more, we'd also like to send you the 10 CD series, 10 Choices, a proven plan to change your life forever, as well as the 10 Choices Bible Study. In this highly practical, impactful series, James MacDonald shares 10 choices that are sure to change your life forever. In addition, you can dig deeper with your own 120-page workbook that will help free you from guilt and regret and stop you from carrying around old hurts and anger. Ask for 10 choices when you call 800-545-6800 or go now to jamesmacdonald.tv.
Well, why are we here? And not certainly because I look in the mirror and think, now there's a face for television. It's because we love you and because God has changed our life through a book. The end game of walking the Word is not more of me in more places preaching God's Word, but we're actually planting gospel-saturated, Bible-believing New Testament churches around the world. And you can go online to harvestbiblefellowship.org and get our suggestions of an awesome, God-honoring, Jesus-focused vertical church near you. That's part of God's provision, not that you would feed yourself exclusively from TV, we're glad to be a supplement, but that you would find yourself connected with a life-giving New Testament community. All right?
We can't wait to connect with you again on Walk in the Word TV, and we'll see you next time.
All right.
When the sea is calm and all is right, when I feel your favor flood my life, even in the good I've the good I'll follow you. When the boat is tossed upon the waves, when I wonder if you'll keep me safe, even in the storms I'll follow you, even in the storms I'll follow you. I will follow you. I believe and I